Hey everyone, welcome to Escapees Webinars. Today we're going to talk with Mandy Lea about her experiences solo RVing, especially in her little teardrop. And she's going to share with us how she navigates the lifestyle and some things that come up and some advice for you guys as well. She and I got together in Quartzsite, Arizona a couple weeks ago, actually, and went ahead and sat down and did a video interview. We are going to go ahead and run that video and then we'll be back online.
So hey everyone, my name is Georgiana. I'm with Escapees RV Club, and today we are hanging out in Mandy Lea's teardrop trailer in Quartzsite, Arizona, and we're going to chat a little bit about her experiences as a solo RVer and what it's like for her on the road, what sent her out on the road, and how she makes money and makes it work for her along the way.
Awesome. I'm excited to have you. Welcome to my home.
Yes, it's so cozy and cute. I love it. All right, so as we go along, make sure that if you have any questions that come to mind that you'd like to ask Mandy, go ahead and enter them in the little bar to the side. That way we can make sure that we don't forget about them. And when we get to the end, we'll do a Q&A session with Mandy, and you guys can ask whatever questions about solo RVing, and we can try and get you the best answer we can.
Welcome to my home. This is Phoenix. I live in a tag teardrop trailer. It's made by New Camp, and I simply love it. I full-time in my teardrop, which I found to be kind of unusual. I've met other teardroppers and other full-timers, but I have yet to meet any other full-time teardroppers. I'm a photographer, and I love photography. I love being outside. I love nature. I shoot a lot of landscapes, and I just love to share my story. I like to try to get people out of their comfort zone and show them a world that they may have forgotten existed.
Yeah.
So that's kind of what I try to do with my photography, and living in this teardrop kind of helps me do that.
Fantastic. So like thinking about small scale stuff, so like what drove you to do this? Like whenever you decided to go out solo, like what drove you to like this versus a motorhome or something like that?
Well, what drove me to go full time in the beginning is just, I suffered from what I think a lot of people suffer from, which is really just the worst problem is the mundane life where you forget to live. And I was working, you know, a normal 9-to-5. It was just, it was a lot of work. And then I would freelance in the evenings, and I was just getting burnt out on my passion. And, so I started to think about ways that I could not be burnt out on my passion. And this is what the answer was for me.
Nice.
Now, I mean, as far as why a teardrop, I'm very passionate about the Living Tiny movement and having a small footprint. And although any RV is a wonderful small footprint, this was just, the reasoning behind it was not for space. The reason was to live simpler. And so the simplest way I could think to live was in a teardrop.
That works. So with that comes questions like, how do you handle some of the basic things? Like, for example, a lot of RVers choose what the size that they do for to suit their space needs and like the things that they need. So for example, your kitchen's outside. So what do you do with?
I actually chose, I mean, they had different options. You know, there were definitely options with the kitchen inside. I chose a kitchen outside on purpose because the reason I'm doing this is because I want to live outdoors. And so if I'm stuck inside cooking dinner and doing everything inside, I could easily just as well have an apartment. So I actually preferred the outdoor kitchen because I just really wanted to be outdoors. And I know, I mean, that comes with tons of challenges as far as like weather. So when it rains, I have an awning I can put up. And if the weather's really, 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 really bad, I just don't cook dinner that night. I mean, there's nights when people, you know, order in or go to the grocery store and buy food all the time. So I just do that some nights. But I also have the option of cooking over campfire when I want to, which is like, you know, something I never did in my apartment. And
yeah, most apartments frown on balcony
no,
campfires.
It's very frowned upon. But no, I have, I love it. There's nothing better than an outdoor kitchen to me. I have the best view of any kitchen around.
Oh, yes. Oh, my goodness. Yes. Yeah. Some of the, like, camp coffee by the campfire at, like, 6 a.m. watch the sunrise. Heck, yes. That's awesome. So with that in mind, since you said you love the part about being outside, so what kinds of things have you found to be the most challenging by both living small like this as well as just being a single RVer out there?
Living small is relatively easy, except I would say in extreme temperatures. I've done both negative 14 degree camping and 110 degree camping, and both of them are honestly equally as difficult. It's hard both just logistically, and also it's like hard on you emotionally too. When you deal with a day or two of extreme temps, it's not a big deal, but when you're like living in it 24 hours a day, it can get hard. So this winter, I just spent 2 months in Colorado, and when I was there, everything was freezing. Things I never expected to freeze would freeze. I had things like my cleaning solution, my 409 and my Windex, they froze, and my little Cottonelle hand wipes froze. And then it gets frustrating when you're cold and you just want something to eat, and like everything is frozen. My peanut butter would freeze, my salad dressing would freeze, all my water is frozen. You know, I had a hard time keeping water thawed to drink. Cause if it was in my car or my trailer, either one, it would freeze. So that was really frustrating. My makeup froze. That was really weird. I like went to put some mascara on to do a video blog or something, and I pulled it out and I'm like, seriously, my makeup is frozen. I mean, it was just ridiculous.
Well, so then an argument to that that a lot of RVers might make is, you live in a home on wheels. Why would you stay there?
Because I'm a photographer and snow is beautiful. Like, I can't express how beautiful the winter is. I mean, to sit in a huge, fresh, powdered field that's just perfectly white, and to get to hike through softly drifting snow, and to photograph that, it makes all those troubles worth it. It's like, yeah, there's all these cons. It's freezing. I have a hard time keeping warm. But, like, the minute I get to go on a hike through, like, a winter wonderland, it's just, it makes it all worth it to me.
The elves don't care that your mascara is frozen, do they?
Yeah, no, the elves don't care if my mascara is frozen. But, so, along those lines, I mean, the same can be said for the heat. I've spent a lot of time camping in Texas, where, you know, if I don't have electric for my air conditioner, then I've got to keep everything from melting. And I buy ice, and it melts in, like, a day, and you can't keep anything cold. And I love salads, so it's hard to keep my salads cold. And it just gets wearing after a couple of weeks. It just gets wearing, but it's always worth it in the end. You know, the things you get to see and experience. I'll put up with a lot to get that photo, you know.
Do you think that if you were with somebody else, then that those, would that person's opinion affect the decisions that you're making as far as staying
in those freezing temperatures? It depends on the person. I am a very low-maintenance person, and I would rather freeze and get the good picture. So I would have to have somebody with me who was equally as low maintenance. Yeah, if I had somebody with me who wasn't willing to put up with the things I put up with, it would be a challenge. But, I mean, I guess if I found the right person, there's always, you know, misery loves company, so it's always better to suffer with somebody than alone. But
and you seem to travel with friends pretty frequently, too.
I do,
it's not
yeah.
that you're always out
no,
there by
no,
yourself.
No, I'm not. I have a lot of friends who either join me, and I also have a pretty big community on the road. So usually if I'm in an area, I can find somebody to adventure with me, somebody to go on a hike with me. But at the end of the day, that person is only experiencing that weekend with me, whereas I'm in it for an extended period of time. And that's what makes it hard, is the amount of time you're in the situation. You know, anybody can live tiny for like a weekend, but it's when you're in it for weeks on end where it really starts to become a thing.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. So then with that in mind, do you have any advice? So thinking about, like, traveling by yourself and what that means for you, the space that you've chosen in which to live and that sort of thing, do you have any advice that you would like to offer or do you think would be useful for people who maybe haven't quite hit the road yet but are thinking about it as an individual? things they should think about or budget.
Consider. I mean, there's two different approaches of advice. There's the logistical advice as far as budget and all that. And then there's also one of the biggest things I had to do to get on the road was prepare myself emotionally. And so those are two whole different games you've got to approach. And emotionally, I went on a 6-week road trip by myself before I hit the road. And a lot of people will do a week or two or a few days or a long weekend to test their rig. So first I would say that's not enough. Like, you can't go out on the road for a week to see what it's like. Because you will never hit that emotionally traumatic period where you actually have to fight through it. When I went on the road for 6 weeks, about a month into it is when the loneliness really kicked in for me. And it was terrible. And when I got back, people would ask me, well, how did your test go? And I'd say, oh, it was terrible. I was so lonely. And they'd say, oh, so you're probably not going to live on the road. And I'd say, no, that if anything, this trip convinced me I should live on the road, because now I know what to expect. I know a month in, I'm going to get lonely. Mm-hmm. And I'm expecting it and I'm ready for it. So when I hit the road full time, a month came in, I got lonely, but I was like, it's okay, Mandy, you knew this was going to happen. And I was ready for it. I was prepared. So, emotionally, I would say just like, know it's going to be hard, but know that it's okay. Like, it's okay that life is hard. Life's going to be hard whether you hit the road or not. So you may as well do it somewhere you can experience life. So I would say just like, you know, be open to things being difficult, and that will help you get through them. And just know what to expect. And know it's not all, you know, unicorns and butterflies. But there are a lot of unicorns and butterflies. So, and then logistically. Oh, man. Logistically, I've learned 99% of the things I do now on the road. I thought I was all prepared. I thought I was packed perfect. I thought I got rid of enough stuff. But the truth is, until you physically hit the road, you're not going to know what you need and what you don't need and the way you're going to do things. So a lot of it is just going to be do the best you can before you go, but no, everything's going to change. I have completely unpacked and repacked my whole situation, my car and my camper, like 6 times, like literally just unpacked it. And I've left at least half of what I originally left with, at my parents' house or at friends' houses or whatever, because I just didn't need it and I thought I would. So, my current setup is like almost 100% different than it was the day I left, just because I've learned while I was on the road what I needed and what I didn't need. Nice. So I guess just stay open to, you know, changing and learning, and know you can't have it all figured out the day you leave.
Something you mentioned before was the idea of having community and support. Like, how did you find that? Like, once you hit the road. Of course, everybody has friends when they leave, but how did you find that on the road?
There are so many groups online. My main one, obviously, being escapees. this has been, seriously, and you know what's great is I learned about escapees from another full-timer. I was on the road, and I was sitting around a campfire with some other full-timers, and we're just chatting like, oh man, you know, life's hard. And we're just kind of reminiscing about how hard it is to do life. And he said, oh, don't you get your mail through the escapees? And I said, no. And that changed my life. It really did. Aside from just the services that the escapees offer, the community is amazing. And since then I've met 100 other people. So I would say definitely stay open to being social on the road, and don't just hermit yourself in your little camper. You know, aside from escapee, there's all kinds of Facebook groups and online communities and people you just meet on the road too. But, particularly with the escapees, you know, I've noticed that you meet somebody one time and you're friends for life. Mm-hmm. You could see that person once a year, but the minute you see them, you just pick up, you know, where it left off. And so it's a great community. I love it.
Awesome. Well, yeah. I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah. Unsolicited advice. Seriously. I love it. Wait, let me check this. Let me see how far. And...
That needs to go in the bloopers. That sounded like it hurt. Like, I felt the walls shake.
Sometimes living in a tiny home can hurt.
Thanks, guys, for watching. So we've got quite a few questions already coming in, and don't forget to keep adding those to the chat. That way we can, as we go along, we can make sure we get those answered too. And thank you, Mandy, for putting that video together. It was so much fun getting
to meet
you in course.
Can you hear me?
Fantastic job.
Can you hear me okay?
Oh, yeah.
Perfect.
So we've got quite a few questions already. Some of them are about some of the gear and the way that you you travel. So Todd asks, do you have a solar setup or a generator? Like, how do you handle that sort of thing with boondocking?
So at the moment, I don't have a solar setup. I have a Goal Zero battery that is separate from my 12-volt battery, and that'll charge. And that battery will give me about another charge or two on my laptop, which is like the main thing I need to keep working on the road. But my 12 volt battery will last me a good, I don't know, like 3 days with my refrigerator. And my lights will run for weeks on my 12 volt battery. So, I'm still waiting on the solar decision to be made, but, it'll come down the line.
Awesome. And so on talking about equipment, TV or antenna and such, do you use?
So the tag teardrop that I have comes with a TV in it, and it comes with like a DVD player and a built-in antenna and all that. But in the 2 years that I've had my tag, I think I watched maybe two movies the whole time I've had it. I don't watch TV at all. I just simply have too much, I don't know, outdoor life to do. So I don't miss it at all. I feel absolutely no need for it. But there is a, you know, if I were at an RV park, there is a cable connection. And I think I packed a cable TV cord, and I've like literally never pulled it out. So, you know, I don't know. It just hasn't been a thing for me.
Well, talking about outdoor stuff, Leonard asked, what kind of kayak do you have?
That is, okay, so I decided I needed a kayak, but I'm not like a professional kayaker. And so I was okay with like, you know, the cheapest kayak I could find, but it had to be orange. So I spent a really long time looking for a cheap kayak, which is really hard to find. And I finally found one at Dick's. It was like $199 because it was on sale, and they had an orange one. And I think I had to drive like 5 hours to get an orange one, but I live on the road, so that was fine. And it's a Pelican. And it was, like I said, it was from Dick's. It was like literally whatever the cheapest kayak was. But I love it. It floats and I can paddle around in it and it's perfect. So
still talking about your setup. Stephanie's asked if you can talk a little bit more about your tow vehicle.
Yeah. So I used to have a Mazda CX-5, which is kind of a crossover. The towing capacity is 2000 pounds and, it pulled my teardrop okay, but it wasn't perfect. And with the number of miles I put on it, it wasn't quite doing it for me. So about, 4 months ago, I just traded in and I got a Jeep Cherokee Trailhawk, that has the tow package built in. So, my new towing capacity is 4,500 pounds, which is like way more than I actually need, but it's perfect because it gives me a lot of wiggle room, you know, to carry more weight and do whatever. The gas mileage is a little bit worse. I get maybe, it's terrible. When I'm towing, I get like 14, 15 miles a gallon, which is not great, but it's part of the job, you know, it's one of my expenses. Also, I'm sorry, this is like literally the first time I have been sick on the road, and I just got a cold yesterday, so I'm getting over it. I've got some hot tea.
So Patty asked, talking about your kayak again, do you use a PFD with your kayak?
A life jacket, I assume, so. A personal flotation device. I do. I mean, I carry it. I don't always put it on, but I always have it in the kayak with me because I know a lot of states actually require that. So, I mean, you know, I have one.
All right. So talking about your outdoor adventures, Ken has asked, what kind of safety precautions do you recommend or do you take whenever you hike solo? Some of us may have already heard about the bear spray. If you want to talk about
that's a really good question. So I mean, you know, there's a lot of different safety reasons, you know, you need to be aware of. One is wildlife, in which case I always carry bear spray if I'm in an area that has active wildlife in it. Do not spray yourself with bear spray. Just not a good idea. It hurts. But you also have to just make sure that you know the trail that you're going on before you go. You know where you're going. You're not just kind of randomly going in the woods. And if I'm hiking alone, I always tell somebody where I'm going. So like I might call my mom and say, "Hey mom, you know, I'm going on this hike in this forest." And that way, if she doesn't hear from me for 5 days, at least the search parties know where to search. So always let somebody know where you're going to be. Make sure you know the trails. Make sure you carry bear spray. And really just use your head, you know. It's a lot of it is just honestly common sense. If something doesn't seem like a good idea, you know, don't do it. Sorry.
Get some water. So Gail asked, talking about safety still, as a single woman, how does your security come into play? Do you carry a weapon? Do you travel with other people? That sort of thing.
Again, I do carry a weapon, but a lot of it again is just common sense. You know, don't put yourself in a dangerous situation. And if a situation doesn't feel right, listen to your gut and get out of it. You know, we're all smart human beings, and if you just trust yourself and you trust that you're smart enough, you know, you just don't put yourself in those situations. And I do travel with people a lot. And if I'm ever alone and in a weird spot, again, I text family or friends and I tell them where I'm staying that night. If I ever feel weird, I might say, "Hey, mom, make sure I'm okay tomorrow." And then I'll send her my coordinates or my locations. They also make little small GPS trackers that you can wear or just carry with you. And if you ever feel like you're in danger, there's like an emergency button you can push, and it'll send your coordinates to whoever you want to send them to. So.
If I remember correctly from past conversations, you have one of those trackers actually on your teardrop now, don't you?
I do, yes. Not only for safety, but also in case anybody decides they want to take Phoenix from me again, I can find her. Yeah.
Smart. All right. So talking about Phoenix then, Patty asked, she commented about your teardrop tattoo on your foot. I don't know if you're able to show it again right now, but maybe.
Oh, I am. I totally
Okay.
am. Yeah. So actually, when I got my first teardrop bird song, before it ever got stolen, I was so obsessed with my teardrop that I got a tattoo of it on my foot with the teal stripes. And then when bird song got stolen and I got Phoenix, everybody said, "Well, aren't you going to get another tattoo?" And I said, "If I get a tattoo with every teardrop I ever own, I'm going to have them go up my leg." So what I did was I added orange stripes to my teal stripes. Let me see if I can get it in front of the camera here. There we go.
There you go,
So
Pat.
that's my teal stripes and then my orange ones and my little heart. Because I just really, even from, I mean, from the moment I bought my teardrop, I loved it. So,
That's awesome.
yeah.
So getting personal again, Cookie asked, how do you compensate for not having a bathroom in your tag?
You know, I've never missed having a bathroom. I like to ask people this. When have you ever been like out in public and needed to go to the bathroom and literally just not been able to find a bathroom? Like there are bathrooms everywhere. You can always find a restaurant, a grocery store, a gas station. Like there's bathrooms anytime you're in a city. And if I'm not in a city, then I'm camping out in the wilderness and I have absolutely no problem squatting. It's never been a problem for me. I actually was just thinking I'm going to do a video blog about women squatting and telling everybody how to do it right because it's not that bad. It's not that hard. And I don't mind getting up in the middle of the night and walking 10 feet out my door and using that bathroom and then going back to bed. So it's just never been an issue for me. And if you're in a city, it's easy to find. Yeah.
Okay, so going with your camping stuff, Patty asked, visiting the teach said visiting the Tetons, top of her bucket list, are some of the off the beaten path type places in the Grand Tetons. Tetons.
Oh my gosh, you pretty much can't go wrong in the Tetons. But what I would suggest for both the Tetons and Yellowstone is that there's a lot of tourists there, but they're all what I like to call parking lot tourists, where they pretty much take these big buses or drive, and they literally just drive to a pull-off, and they get out of the car, and they take pictures, and then they keep going. And there's just, I mean, crowds and crowds of people doing this. So if you choose literally any hike in the Tetons, they're all beautiful. But get yourself a mile or two off of the road, and suddenly there's going to be no people because nobody wants to hike. And you're going to, it's so beautiful. You can't go wrong with any of the hikes. So I would just recommend, like, do more than just drive places. Don't just drive up to the lake. Don't just drive up to the sightseeing spots. Take a hike. There's some really nice 1, 2, 3 mile hikes, and there's some really far ones too. So I say just get off the road and go see it.
Nice. So Cookies asked, how do you go about planning your trips to your destinations from day to day? Do you let the road lead you? I know you've got quite a full calendar of speaking engagements and such coming up as well.
Yeah. You know, unfortunately I have to make a living like anybody else. And so I do have to, I have to take the jobs and the events that pay me. And so I let those be kind of my waypoints. And then I make sure to leave space in between them so that I can spend extra time or I can go do whatever I want in between. And there are national and state parks everywhere. And every state, regardless of its reputation, every state has something pretty to see. So, you know, I pretty much go where the jobs take me, and then I try to make lots of extra time to see cool things.
So Ramona asks, like, how do you locate where you want to hike?
Honestly, the internet has so much information on it. I mean, you know, Google, you can Google anything. People have pictures, people have reviews. I follow a lot of blogs from other full-timers. There's a great full-time community you can hook up with through Escapees or, you know, Facebook, anybody. And I start just following my friends, and most of them have been to an area before, and I'll read blogs, Google, you know, even the state parks, the visitor centers have like really great information for hikes. So all the info's out there.
And I know just from personal experience too, whenever you go to these parks, if you stop in at one of the little camp stores or visitor centers and just talk to the park rangers.
Oh yeah.
They've got tons and tons of recommendations. They can usually help you narrow down. Do you want a long hike, a short hike, intense, whatever.
They love talking to the people too. So yeah, you can go tell them you want a short 1 mile hike and they'll have a bunch. So.
Let's see. Talking about companionship, Scott and Janice asked, have you ever thought about having a pet with you on the road?
Yeah. I am like, you know, this close to getting a dog. I want the right pet, and I want, you know, I don't want to force it. I want it to be at the right time, you know, probably a rescue of some sort, but I don't have a particular breed. And I just know that when I find it, I'll find it. And, but yeah, I do. I think about it pretty much every day.
Awesome. Well, so with talking about loneliness, then Bruce asked, it's like you brought it up that overcoming loneliness can be hard. Yeah. What do you feel is your biggest challenge?
With regards to loneliness?
I guess so.
well, I mean, that alone is my biggest challenge. You know what? I can tell you the moments when I feel the most lonely are, When I go on a great hike, or I go find something really beautiful, or I go watch a really beautiful sunrise, and I'm by myself, and all you want to do is turn to somebody almost to verify its beauty and just like share it and be like, hey, dude, look at this. Like, that's amazing. And when you're alone and you can't just like, you look around like, dude, is anyone else seeing this? Is it just me? Those are the moments that are the most lonely. But that's why I love sharing my photos, is because I'll be there and instead of having somebody to turn to, I can just think, oh my gosh, I'm going to take the best picture I can take of this, and I'm going to go share it with all of my Facebook friends and all my social media friends. And even though it's not the same, It does kind of give me a little encouragement that, hey, I'm going to get to share this with somebody in some form or another.
On that note, somebody had asked earlier, how do you feel about your large following? I mean, even here right now, we have 320 people registered and there's 100 people watching us talk. And I mean, you have thousands of followers on Facebook and other outlets.
I am completely humbled, honestly. When people began following me, I just, I originally thought, oh, these are just like, are these even real people? Are they a bunch of fake hackers or whatever? And the more and more people started following me, the more I would get personal messages and emails of just really personal stories about ways I've helped them and ways I've inspired people. And I started to realize these were like real people, and I'm just absolutely like humbled, and it keeps me going every day. Like it really, whenever I'm feeling down, I just think about all the people who I can touch, and it makes me keep going.
Awesome. So talking more about people, Jim asks, how do you get away from that occasional person that becomes a little bit too clingy? Do you just pack up and leave, or do you have a tactful way of getting away from them but staying in the same area?
I haven't. I move so much. I travel literally every 2 to 3 days. With the occasion when I go home and stay at my parents for a little while, I'm never in a spot long enough to really get people being clingy. And if I have a friend join me, it's usually like they're joining me for a week or a few days or whatever. And so I haven't really gotten stuck with anybody, you know.
Nice. And so thinking about space, spatial type of things, Julie asks, did you consider a tab before you went with a tag?
I did look at them, and what's funny too is when I bought my first teardrop, I didn't buy it with the intention of actually living in it. I thought I was just going to travel in it, and so I didn't think I needed the tab, and it was heavier and it was more expensive, and I didn't want to have to get a new car. I didn't think my Mazda could really pull it, so I looked at it, but I didn't really seriously consider it. And when I saw the tag, like seriously, it had, it's just adorable. It's got the vintage little look with the cute little, and at the time it was the turquoise one I was looking at, the cute little turquoise fenders. Like I looked at it and it didn't make as much practical sense, but there was just a feeling. Like I saw it and I was like, I have to have that one. Even though it doesn't make sense, that's the one I have to have. And it wasn't until I had already been traveling in it for about a year that I actually decided to live in it. And since I've been living in it, I love living tiny. I love the simple life. But I do every now and then consider getting a tab. I feel like I could get a tab without it being giving up my standards of tiny living. They're still pretty tiny, so I don't know. I consider it every now and then.
I think you love campfires enough that that tab won't keep you inside for too long. That's
No,
just
no.
outside.
Yeah, no, it won't.
So a couple of questions about internet came up. How do you access internet from places that don't have Wi-Fi, or like do you use cell phone booster, that sort of thing?
So, I have a service which I can send y'all the link to if you want, but it's actually a really great deal on a it's not through Verizon, but it's a company that uses the Verizon network, and you can get almost unlimited data anytime you have Verizon service. So anytime I'm in cell phone range, I have a hotspot that gets me internet. If I'm not in a Verizon network, I don't have internet. And that's okay, it's okay to go off grid for a couple of days. So sometimes you guys might see I don't post for 2 or 3 days, and that usually just means I'm camping for 2 or 3 days, and then I catch up when I get back. But having internet anywhere I have my cell phone service is really handy.
Nice. I know there's all kinds of tools. Like if even if you're a member, I think Wi-Fi Ranger. There's a discount worked out for Scapees members where you can save some money on their gear, which helps you with boosting signal.
Right. Yeah, and I don't have a booster yet. That is something I'll we'll have to talk after this. I'm interested in a booster. Yeah.
Okay, and one more question from Cookie. She asks, she's considering a rooftop storage for her TV. What do you carry in yours? And I think she's referring to your
On the car.
the box you have on your Jeep for carrying extra stuff.
Yeah, right. I got it's just I mean, the two main companies that make them are Thule and Yakima. And I got this Yakima one because it was a good deal. I bought it used from one of my friends, but they make all kinds of different sizes. And I keep a lot of my outdoor gear that I don't have to access all the time up there. And just some of the bulkier stuff. I carry most of my gear in my car and in that box. I try to keep my teardrop like as clear as possible so that I always have like a nice clean space to go to. I don't know if I answered it. Did I answer the question?
Yes, she's asking what brand you have, what do you carry in yours, that sort of thing. That makes sense. And I know I personally prefer coming home and gut crashing in a well-made bed
Oh
than
yeah.
the
Yeah.
capital, so
It's
I fully understand.
tempting to just it's so tempting to just store stuff in the teardrop because it's like this big open space, right? But then when you pull over, you can't you can't just like fall in and go to bed, which is what I really like to do. So
You pull some really long driving days, so I can
yeah, I
understand
do. Yeah,
crashing when you're
that's
finally done.
or just to be able to take a nap, you know, in the middle of your driving day. Oh, I'm gonna go. Here's my house. I'm just gonna pull over and take a nap. It's nice. So.
We're talking about Phoenix, Faye has asked that she is curious if you've had any trouble backing up your trailer. She says she has a 68-year-old grandmother and she wants to start RVing, but her
Right.
children are worried about her being able to handle a trailer.
I will say that for the first maybe month or so that I had it, I was terrible at it. Yeah, I was absolutely awful. When you first get in and if you've never backed up a trailer before, you're gonna be awful at it. But I mean, I had to do it every day. And it's like anything else, practice makes perfect. After a month of doing it, I'm like a pro now. Seriously, I can back up into any spot. But yeah, no, I was terrible at it when I started, and you just keep going and you just learn and you get used to it, you feel it. So now it's super easy. And it's easy to tow. Honestly, the teardrop is like it's lightweight. There's hardly any maintenance on it. It takes me 5 minutes to unhook it, 5 minutes to hook it up. It's super simple.
That's fantastic. Jim has asked, what about like weather issues when you have to stay inside for a couple of days? I know with most RVs, that's a situation at some point. But how do you handle that, or have you experienced it?
So yeah, in the so where the kitchen is, I have a 10 by 10 foot one of the pahake awnings that you can put up. And so if it's just rain and it's not like freezing, I just put that up and I can chill outside or I can sit inside. Honestly, it's quite comfortable.
I can attest to
Yeah,
that.
absolutely. And so rain doesn't bug me too much. And then cold weather, I'm usually out, you know, I'm out hiking or something. I went snow camping, and it just wasn't really an issue, but you also have to be you know, I'm pretty low maintenance. I don't mind the cold. I love the snow. Honestly, the heat bugs me more. When I was in Texas over the summer, if you don't have shade, it's hard. But I can pull a day in my teardrop, pull out my laptop, hang out. It doesn't bug me.
Nice. Cookie asks, where do you store your power cord, your water hose, that sort of thing?
There's an LP tank on the front of it, and so. The cover that covers that propane tank that sits on the front, there's a battery in there, and then there's some extra space. I keep all my extension cords. I keep my chocks for the tires in there. My hoses I've attached. If you guys look at pictures, you'll see there's an extra toolbox I put on the tongue, and I keep all my hoses and my extension cord adapters and tools in there. So, yeah, spot for everything.
Oh yes, and especially whenever you learn what you really do and don't need, you don't need quite as much space.
Yeah, I've recently gotten rid of a lot of the things I have. I just stopped by my parents' house in Colorado and emptied everything. I left, you know, again, boxes of stuff that I thought I needed and I just don't.
Well, Wayne has asked, how airtight is your tag? Do you have issues with any kind of pests and such getting inside?
No, only the ones I let in. Yeah, it's very airtight. It's not, it has insulation, but not a lot. So like over the winter, there's a lot of like if I would breathe overnight and the condensation would freeze to my ceiling, I'd wake up and there would be like ice inside. That was kind of frustrating. And it's not super noise proof either. Like I can hear a lot, but it's pretty airtight. I never get rain or water or wind or anything inside of it. Never get bugs, never get spiders, which is good because I hate spiders, obviously. Very much. I hate spiders.
Oh yes. Well, so thinking about some of these other things, Patty asks, like, what type of locks do you use on Phoenix? Of course, you have the chocks, which aren't really locks, but also like tire locks, tongue lock, that sort of thing.
I have quite a few. So in addition to having my GPS tracker, I also have a tire lock, which is honestly, I can't remember the brand, but it looks like a claw. And it was like $70. And that's, I think that is the best lock, honestly. It's really hard to break and it's like a huge deterrent. People see that and they just don't even want to try. And then I also have a hitch lock, which is like a ball that goes up into the hitch. And you lock it on there so that nobody can hitch it up and drive it away. And then there's also a peg lock that goes over the handle for your hitch. And that comes in a set with the same key. So I have like three locks and a GPS tracker. And then the doors lock, obviously.
Yeah, something that people can keep in mind, especially if they're considering small trailers like a teardrop, is I know I've been able to do it before, and I'm not that strong. It doesn't take a lot of effort to lift it and roll it. So things that, like Mandy mentioned, those
Right.
wheel locks are actually important that keep the
Exactly.
wheels.
Because even if you have the hitch locked, if somebody comes by with a big flatbed trailer, they could just roll it up on there and take it. Or they can break it, you know. When Birdsong was stolen, I had a hitch lock on the handle and they just broke it. So I didn't have the tire lock on at that time.
And there are also some people who've brought up in past conversations I've had, because I'm considering a teardrop as well. And things like, I believe some of the teardrops have the spare tire mounted on the outside of the trailer. And so make sure that you have that secured somehow so somebody can't take the wheel lock off of one wheel, put your spare on it, and still take off with your trailer.
That's a great idea because it doesn't take long to change a tire. If you're ready and prepared and you know what you're doing, you can just get in there, switch it out. Yeah. So, I mean, if somebody's, and that's, you know, any lock is just a deterrent. They can all be broken. They can all, you can find a way around anything, but if it's too hard, people are not going to bother. So, and you know, just be safe. Don't leave it in a dark alley for a month.
Yeah. So going back to some of the stuff inside the teardrop, Stephanie asks, is there a heater in it?
The tag does not come with a heater, but I just bought one of those little ceramic heaters. They're like $20 at Walmart, literally any outdoor store. And so I can only use it when I have electricity, but it heats that thing so fast. Like 2 minutes, the whole teardrop will be hot. And then I also have a Mr. Heater little propane thing that it sits on top of a propane bottle. And I think for a normal camper, that's a perfect solution. For the teardrop, it was a little bit hard because I didn't have, like, there's no good spot to set it really because you just have a bed. So I used it every now and then, but it wasn't my favorite. I'd rather just use my electric heater. And then I also have, honestly, I have a down sleeping bag. So when I was in Colorado, it was 0 degrees and I was off grid. And I didn't want to use my propane heater. I just got in my sleeping bag. I mean, it's like camping, you know?
Oh yeah. So Ken has asked, looking at food storage, how do you prevent spoilage?
So I have a fridge, which, you know, works like a fridge. And most of the time that works, even when I don't, when I'm not plugged into electric, I can still use it for a couple days. Now, if I know I'm going to be off grid for too long, I have an a Dometic cooler that, you know, I fill with ice. A lot of it too is just planning what you buy. So I don't eat out much. I grocery shop all the time, but I just plan it out, and you don't buy too much at once. You know, that's going to go bad. And I just buy it where I know I can eat through it. But I mean, normally my fridge is enough. And then I have a drawer in my car that's like my pantry, which is all my dried foods. So I keep all that in my car. And yeah, it works out really well.
That works. Well, that's all that we have for questions. I know you're starting to lose your voice, so that's probably a good time.
Yeah, I'm sorry. This is probably terrible to listen to.
It can happen.
I know.
But John brought up a good point that I want to talk with you guys about real quick. A lot of the questions we had tonight were about safety with your RV, how to handle it, maintenance, that sort of thing. And one of the things that Escapees offers, I've actually gotten to attend it myself and loved it. And I don't even have an RV yet, but it's Escapees Boot Camp. It's taught by a couple of our industry professionals. Mark Nemeth is one of our staff members that works on that. Some of you guys may have seen his articles in several of the publications out there in the RV world. But also there are several other professionals that are there, and they teach how to drive your RV. They teach you all kinds of like safety systems. They'll go through step by step on how your black water and your clean water and all that sort of thing, and like, all the electricity. They even do a little bit of discussion about solar and that sort of thing. And it's usually 2 to 3 days of anywhere from 6 to 8 hours a day of these short seminars talking about all these different things, and you can pick and choose what you want to go to. But it's a really great way, especially if you're a brand new RVer or you're still in the shopping phase and trying to figure out what you want to do. It's a great way to learn about those different kinds of RVs to figure out what's best going to work for you, as what your abilities are to handle that sort of thing. And you can always find out about a little bit more about that on our Escapees website at escapees.com. And there's a little section for education, and that's where you're going to find that information about the boot camp. But do you have anything else that you'd like to share, Mandy, before we say goodnight and let you?
I'm just really grateful, first of all, for anybody who's like interested in following my adventures and my story, because it really is all of you guys that is the reason I do this. When I'm out there hiking alone and I'm lonely, I just think about all the people's lives that I'm touching, and I'm so unbelievably grateful for you guys. So I'm going to, you know, obviously continue to get the most beautiful landscape shots I can get. And I'm really going to get more into my video blogging, because there's so much I want to say and share. So stick with me. And if you guys don't follow me, I have a YouTube channel. It's just Mandy Lea. So you can find me on YouTube and watch my video blogs, and just stick with me and comment on things, and it makes me feel less lonely. So thank you for being with me.
I really appreciate you taking the time to hang out with us tonight and talk about your experience.
Absolutely.
Build all these. Yeah. And I know that she and I both appreciate all of you guys being here. Thank you for taking the time and hanging out through some of the little things that happen with connection with RVers on the road. Sometimes you don't have the best signal, but and so it makes for weird audio and such. But thank you guys for hanging out still and joining us on this. Thank you again for sharing your evening with us.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me.
I hope you guys all have a wonderful night.
All right. Good night.